Hello, everyone. I want to welcome you to the Feel Free Again podcast. If you don't know me, my name is Cole James, and I host this show. And really, the show is all about talking openly about emotional things, emotional pain from our past, grief, trauma, loss, sadness. We want to be able to openly talk about those things. A lot of the guests that I have on also have a passion to help other people with their grief and their loss. So sometimes we're talking about us and our heart. Sometimes we're talking about how we help others professionally. And so thank you for joining us. Today, I'm very pleased and excited to have on Adrienne Mejias. She is someone that does our method, the grief recovery method, and she is a LMFT, and those for those that don't know, that's a licensed marriage and family therapist. She is coming to us from, Lafayette, not Lafayette.
Near Lafayette, correct. Yeah.
Okay, somewhere there. Okay, so basically Louisiana, and I'm all the way over on the other side of the country in Idaho. So anyway, but she helps people there as a therapist in Louisiana. And so we're going to get into a lot of things. I want to talk to her about how she's utilized these tools professionally. I want to talk to her about how she has utilized these tools personally with some of the losses that she's had in her life. And again, just have a conversation about all of that. So without any further ado, Adrienne, I just want to say thank you for joining us. How are you doing today?
I am great. Thank you so much for having me.
And I have to warn you, this is a little sidebar. I've been trying to not drink coffee, and I've been pretty good about it for like several weeks, but I was feeling really flat before our call. And I said, you know what? A little green tea won't hurt. And I am flying high right now. So I'm going to just slow me down if you need to, because this is me on caffeine.
Yeah, so
anyway, there you go. Okay, cool. So we're both there. Awesome. So let's do this again. I really want you to talk. I want this conversation to go where you want it to go. But if you don't mind, can you let us know a little bit? I always like to start here in terms of how did you find your way to learning about the grief recovery method and kind of what we do?
Okay. So I was a therapist before I became a grief recovery method specialist. And really what happened, it's interesting. I was a therapist first. And then my husband and I became involved in a ministry, a church ministry, that helped parents who were grieving the loss of a child. Through that ministry and through counseling individuals, I realized that to help people who were grieving, I just needed more than what I had. I found myself so many times in a therapy session where, you know, there was someone who was, you know, just so brokenhearted in front of me, and I didn't know what to say. I had compassion, had empathy. You know, there were a few words that I could say, I'm so sorry. And the things that I would often say, this is fresh, you've got to give yourself time, you know, the dreaded time thing that we say. But I didn't know what else to do. I just felt so stuck. So through the ministry, I started to, ask more about like, gosh, I wish there was more training in grief. And, there weren't specific programs or there wasn't a course I could take just for, you know, for grief. And so one of my friends actually told me about the method. So I got onto this was in 2019. I Googled it. We were sitting at Starbucks having coffee and I Googled it and I was like, oh, I've never even heard of this. This is so interesting. So I started to look at the training dates and there was a training in Baton Rouge, which is about an hour from where I am it was like in 2 months. So I said, oh my gosh, the timing. This is so incredible.
Yep.
So I signed up right away. And I was like, oh my gosh, 4 days. Wow. But in my mind, because I've done CEUs and, you know, this continuing education stuff, I've attended conferences. I'm imagining sitting there like in kind of a classroom style, taking notes, listening, getting all these tools and pointers to help people. And then when I got there,
I know where this is going. I know where this is going.
I walk in there, yeah. There were four other women. There's Ed. And I'm like, oh, okay, hey. And he quickly, you know, told me that part of the training was to actually go through the method. And I was like, ooh, I don't know that I signed up for this.
So right.
I knew all of the grief that I had been carrying for years from my early 20s. So I was like, I thought I was just coming to find out how to help other people, not realizing what I was going to be doing for myself.
Wow.
It was incredible.
So yeah, you're in the training and Ed's telling you, okay, here's kind of the agenda for the weekend. And you're like, whoa, time out. I'm the professional here. I'm helping other people. I'm here for tools that help other people. And so you get that news. If you're okay with it, right? Let's kind of pause there in your journey with the training and get into maybe let's go step back a little bit, because you mentioned that you're we're doing a ministry to help people with the loss of a child and stuff like that. So let's, if you're okay with it, let's go to what work did you end up working on? The personal work that you were describing in the certification, what work did you end up doing? What, you know, loss brought you here now that you know, okay, we're going to do our own.
Yes.
Work.
And funny enough, it was other people's losses that I thought were bringing me there. And then when I found out too, that I was going to be going through this whole personal journey for myself. I mean, I immediately knew that the work that needed to be done was on the loss of my children. That, I mean, I was 22 and I'm 42 now. So we're talking, you know, this was almost 20 years prior, losses that I had faced that, you know, I handled the way most people do. You just kind of have to go through life. We would kind of retell, my husband and I would retell our story. That was part of the ministry that we were doing. Okay. We would retell our story. But that was about it. We were just sharing a story. We were rehashing pain.
Sure. Wow. And I want to be careful here, as we always do on this podcast, because, you know, this podcast isn't the, hey, let's beat ourselves up for things we didn't know when we didn't know them, right? And so a lot of the time we get really good people. We get therapists that are like, you know what? I love helping people. I'm good at helping people. And I care so much that when I identify a little hole in my game in terms of when we veer into the topic of grief, I feel like I could be doing more for my clients, mm-hmm. right? And so they seek us out. Same with this applies for people who have a loss and then they want to get into that field and help other people with loss, right? I mean, that's a courageous, well-intentioned thing. So we're not trying to beat people up that are doing that, because that's such an important thing too. But a lot of the time what happens is if we don't know what we're doing in those places, we just can't offer them all that that maybe we could, right? Right. And so I think that's probably where our conversation is going to go, just because I know some of your story. But you're out there and you're wanting to help other grieving people, right? And I don't want to go past what you mentioned, because you mentioned you lost children, right? Plural. And I can't even imagine what that was like for you and your husband. Can you tell us a little bit more about the details of what happened?
Yes. So we were very young when we got married. We were 20 years old. And it was about a year into our marriage that I learned that I was pregnant. I was still in college. You know, at the time I was upset that, well, timing, I'm supposed to be graduating. I'm going to have the baby, thinking, you know, I was going to have to put off graduating from college for a little bit. The pregnancy was wonderful. We lived in a very small town near my parents. And life was just very simple. At that time, there really weren't cell phones or anything like that. It was just a very, very quiet, simple life. And so this pregnancy was wonderful. And then when I had go into the hospital, I had to be induced. So go into the hospital. Once again, everything was fine as far as we knew. And when Emma was born, she was my firstborn, we learned immediately that there were many issues. There were physical abnormalities that were noticed. There were just a lot of issues that we didn't even recognize at the time because they whisked her away and, you know, brought her into the NICU. I didn't get to see her for hours after she was born. And the first word we even heard from anyone was the NICU doctor coming in to tell us that there was something wrong. They didn't know what it was. And they went, like, they just read off this laundry list of all of the issues they saw with her. And this was before I even laid eyes on her. And this was after a 20-hour delivery. So it was incredible. When we finally got to meet her, I mean, we felt so excited, blessed, terrified all at the same time. And we didn't realize it, but it would be a few weeks before we would even have answers. They were doing all of this testing. And at the time it seemed that Emma's biggest issues revolved around her intestines, feeding issues, GI issues. So that was our primary concern at the time. And then we found the diagnosis a few weeks later. We found out that she had, it's called Smith-Lemli-Opitz. And it's a syndrome where she did not produce cholesterol, basically. My husband and I each carry a recessive gene for this syndrome. So that means that we have a 25% chance of having a child with this for each pregnancy. You know, so 75% chance of having a healthy child. So when we found that out and we knew that she needed more care than what we could give her at the hospital, the local hospital, we moved her to New Orleans, to Children's Hospital in New Orleans. And that was a few hours away from home. I moved to New Orleans. My husband, he moved out of our little home. He moved in with my parents. He was working hours away from New Orleans, so he had to stay home. Medical insurance, everything. You know, he could not leave his job. So I was living at the Ronald McDonald House in New Orleans, and he was living with my parents over 2 hours away. He would come on weekends. And this whole time, there's, you know, doctors that are trying to help her with her very complicated situation. So we were in New Orleans for 9 months straight. Wow. And then we needed more help. So we decided to go to Johns Hopkins. And at that point, my husband was able to kind of take a leave from work. He found a job up there, which was incredible. And we lived at the Ronald McDonald House in Baltimore. And we were there for about 6 months. And by this point, Emma is already like a year and a half old, having never left the hospital. There were complications after complications. She had a trach. She had a feeding tube. She had too many surgeries to count. And then of course, in a hospital and with all of these different lines and there were infections and it was almost as though it was like this nightmare that we just couldn't wake up from. If one day was good, there were 3 days of bad that followed. Was one step forward, so many steps back. The amount of times we were told that she was going to die or that we needed to let her go, I mean, it was countless. And then in the meantime, I find out I'm pregnant for our second child. I was terrified. My parents are in Louisiana at this point. We're in Baltimore. To add insult to injury, my dad had a massive heart attack. So we were trying to navigate through. My dad was only 48 at the time. He survived.
Great. But it was, and I just want to, I want to remind the audience, you're 22, 23 years old, right? Dealing with all of this. Wow. I cannot even imagine.
And what's so incredible, I look at the woman I am now and the woman I was then. And I guess, you know, as our brains fully develop and we tend to worry more as we get older and we know more about all the scary things that can happen. I don't even know. I don't think I could handle things as well as I did back then. I think because I just had no choice but to go and go and do. And it was, there was no processing any of it. We had to make big decisions that you couldn't talk about for, you know, a day or two. Let's figure this out. What are we going to do? We just had to act, you know? And so we were dealing with a very sick baby and finding out we're pregnant for a second child. We heard a lot of negative things from the medical field, from family, about having a second child. Not as though we, this was, that we were trying, obviously, but we just, we got a lot of opinions about what we should have done, what we needed to do, what we should not be doing, decisions we shouldn't be making. So it was very easy for us to want to isolate, even from family. Because it's, we just didn't have, we didn't have room for that kind of negativity on top of everything we were dealing with. And then it, I was about 8 weeks, no, about 14 weeks pregnant when we learned that our second baby was also going to have the same syndrome. Her situation was going to be a little bit more complicated, as if Emma's wasn't so complicated. She also had a heart defect, and the way this syndrome is, it's, there's a spectrum of issues that you can have. You know, there's very complicated issues that some cases are very mild, but some are very, very, serious. And our cases happen to be more serious. So found out that, that our second baby, a little girl, Anna, was also going to have the same syndrome, but with more complexities, I guess. And so at that point, we decided that the best thing for us was to come back to Louisiana because we did need some support. And when we moved Emma back, we were coming from one of the best hospitals, you know, in the country, Johns Hopkins, where there's a specialist for everything, even to, you know, start an IV. There is someone who knows exactly what they're doing, to a very small hospital in Louisiana. And things just went downhill so incredibly fast. And the regret and all of the, why did we leave? Why didn't we, you know, can we try to go back? We tried to go back to Johns Hopkins for her sake. And we couldn't, insurance wouldn't even pay for us to return. So we had to make the best decisions we could with what we had. And we decided to try to go back to New Orleans, where I delivered Anna. She was a few weeks premature. I had to have an emergency section because of her heart issue. And Emma at that time was a few miles down the road at a different hospital. So we had our two babies in two different hospitals. And as soon as I could, I was trying to go between both places. And having had major surgery, you know. And this puts us in 2004. So Emma was born in 2003. And so we're at in October of 2004 when Anna was born. And after she was born, I mean, they were once again tending to all of her issues, and we knew she was going to need heart surgery. Unfortunately, she had this blood disorder, this bleeding disorder that would not allow her to have surgery. So, and once again, I look back at this, and you've watched movies where you're like, what else can happen? What are you right. hear the, you know, the characters in the, or the, you know, the actors in the movie saying, what more could happen? At one point I was thinking, I remember looking up at God, like, what do you want from us? What mm-hmm. more can we give? What can we do? We're mm-hmm. pulled in so many directions. You've given us these children to care for, and our hands are so tied in so many ways with what we can do.
Yeah.
So as Anna, a month or two passed with her, Emma got incredibly sick. She had a really bad infection. And so we're nearing the end of 2004. And it was actually in Christmas Eve of 2004 that Emma died. The emotions that we felt, I think anger was a big part of, like, my gosh, we did all of these things. What more could we have done? But also there was relief in that her journey of all of the suffering that she had gone through had come to an end. This was nothing I would have ever said back then, that I felt relief because of what she had gone through.
Yeah, you know, and I just want to say this. First of all, we've never met Adrienne in person, and it's times like this when I hate Zoom and, you know, or whatever app we're on right now, because I would offer you a hug. I don't know what else to say right now other than, would you take a hug? And you could tell me no, but that's what my heart tells me right now. Is like, I want to give you a hug, and I can't imagine what it was like for you and your husband so far in this journey. And I know you know this, but our audience may not know this. This whole grief recovery method, you know, that we're kind of going to talk about today, this was all created by my father, whose baby son died in the hospital and never came home. For him to find some tools to help heal his heart, and then turn that into a book to help other people. And then at some point down the road, years, decades later, right, you lose a baby that never got to come home from the hospital, right? It's just, I'm getting chills just thinking about, like, the power of how things work, right? So I just wanted to mention that we talk about what you're mentioning, which is the definition of grief is conflicting feelings in the change in or end of a familiar pattern of behavior, right? Now, we never introduced this to the grieving person directly because, like you said, they may or may not be ready to look at that, to admit that, or do any of those things. So, of course, we don't want to put them in a position to have to do any of those things. The reason I mention all this is because my dad said something almost exactly verbatim of what you said. He said, you know, if you would have asked me originally whether I was relieved or not, you know, around the death of my son, I would have punched you in the mouth, right? But later on, he was willing to admit that there were some conflicting feelings. There was a sense of relief, right? And this is very normal and natural for grievers. And we just want to put that out there because if we don't put that information out there, then people think something's wrong with them.
Absolutely.
Right? Like when my dad died of cancer a couple of years back, and he had been battling for months, and it was this nightmare that we couldn't wake up from, my mom and my sister and me trying to be his caretakers in the home for months and months and months, seeing the stuff he was going through. When I walked through that door at 2 a.m., right, and I just knew by looking at him next to my mom that the life had left him and he had died at some point that night, I had a lot of relief for him, for our family, right? And it's, again, it's important for us to be able to talk about this openly to each other. Otherwise, we think, oh my God, no one says that. I can't say that. Something's wrong with me. And then we have to go underground with our grief, right? So I just want to thank you for being that courageous to be able to say that, right? Because that's the truth for us when we have these kind of situations, these losses. It's like there are conflicting feelings, and some of them feel very normal, like anger or I can't believe this happened, or you know, all those kind of things. And then sometimes we also have relief, and that's okay too. So I just want our listeners to hear that from Adrienne, from me, from my father way back when he lost a boy that never, his son, who would have been my older brother, his lungs didn't develop, right? And that was kind of what was going on there. But anyway, I want, please continue, Adrienne, just kind of with the story. But again, I just want to offer you a hug because I heard that, you know, and I've never heard your story in details, by the way. I've not heard this story specifically. So it's breaking my heart, you know, and again, that's why I want to give you a hug. But, you know, aside from that, your babies are in two different hospitals, right? And so your husband, I'm assuming your husband and some of your family is supporting one baby, you're supporting another baby in two different hospitals. So, I mean, even that, I can't imagine.
Yes. And it was being at one hospital, calling the other hospital, figuring out because at one point, because Emma was declining so rapidly, but then Anna was doing so poorly as well and needing to have heart surgery. It was like, which one is worse off at this moment that I need to be there? That was how we were gauging it. It's like, which one is worse? It was a very, so overwhelming. It was so exhausting. And then, you know, mentioning too what you said about me being able to say that I was relieved, that freedom only came from the method. I wouldn't have even said this in November of 2019 before I went through the training. I really wouldn't have because, you know, oh my gosh, what kind of mother would feel relief, you know, that her daughter died after 20 months of being in a hospital. It's something that I carried and then felt so bad about feeling. And then it was only 2 weeks later that we lost Anna. So it was Christmas Eve of 2004 and January 6th of 2005. We had two funerals within 2 weeks.
Again, there are times I don't have words. You know, I just don't know what to say at this point other than I'd give you a hug right now.
I appreciate that. Thank you.
I cannot imagine. We have four children. We've had ups and downs at the different births of the children. Yeah. You know, we've had but to be 22 years old, 23 years old, and navigating what you just told us you've navigated, it's truly just heartbreaking. And going back to something you just said, and for the viewers, I don't want you to miss this point. Adrienne and her husband are dealing with this in their 20s, okay? And she doesn't not come to the grief recovery method for about 20 years, you said, right?
15-ish, 16, something like that.
15, right. 2019. Yeah, don't make me do math. Even caffeine can't help me
it's
do math.
It's 20 years so, now.
So anyway, let's say 15 years, right? But 15 years, you're out there. And again, we'll get to this in a second, I'm sure. But like you're out there doing a ministry to help other people with child loss specifically, I think you were saying. And you're out there helping people. But we're still holding these things for 15 years. And again, this is nothing about you. This is about tools being available or tools not being available, information being available or not being available. And that's, you know, honestly, why our whole passion to do this podcast, to do YouTube and to do blogs, just to get more information out there so that hopefully, right, Adrienne, someone is watching this. And they don't have to hold that for 15 years. They can just find one of us and say, you know what? I wouldn't say this to an audience right now, but yeah, I was relieved when my dad died. I was relieved when my child died. Don't mistake that for me wanting it to happen or being okay with any of that, but there were some feelings there. And that way we can relate to each other, right? And that's a great piece of it. So I'm sure we'll get into other stuff, but please continue. So you got to bury two of your baby girls within weeks of each other. I want to stay here, Adrienne, if you're okay with it, because again, some people that are listening to this, they're not ready for grief recovery. They're not ready for new tools. They're just there in their grief, right? So I want to be able to share with them the ups, the downs, the highs, the lows in kind of your journey after the death of your girls, you and your husband looking to put you guys back together? Like, and again, where did that start? Was that months and months later, you know, were you just still in like survival mode of like making choices and not have like compartmentalizing everything, not being able to even go to the heart? I imagine that happened for a while. I mean, we can go anywhere you want again, because you've opened your heart so courageously and you're going to help a lot of people with this. So we can go wherever you want. But where I'm kind of curious is the things that you did as a griever following those losses that were helpful, the things that you tried that were not helpful. You know, again, if we can help people who are in marriages after the loss of a child, right? And people argue this all day long. I don't want to get into it, but for a lot of people, the loss of a child can really destroy a marriage, right? I know that happened with my father and his wife at the time. Again, we can go wherever you want, but if you can just tell us a little bit about your journey after your girls died and kind of where you guys went from there, the journey of two grievers that are young in their 20s. And I mean, where do you go after that?
Right. Well, and yeah, because our first year of marriage was really the only time that we had together before we were pretty much separated and then living in this kind of fight or flight mode.
Wow.
Even that first, you know, or instead of dealing with the typical things that young couples have to figure out, you know, about life and finances and chores and just all of those things, we were trying to figure out like, okay, so what are we going to do with our children? Where are we going to go? Now we find out that there's, you know, a possibility that every pregnancy can result in this. We always imagined having a very large family. I was the baby of four.
Sure.
I wanted four, six children, which was part of why we were very happy, although it wasn't in our plan to get pregnant within the first year of marriage. We were also happy because we knew we wanted a big family. So we were
right.
And, yep. And there were our hopes and dreams about what our future would look like, what our family would look like, lots of children. So right after everything happened, I think it's so normal to just go with what where the world leads you. It's like, okay, well, no, you have bills to pay. I mean, now you're not living in the hospital, Adrienne. What are you going to do with your life? You need to finish college. So I was able to finish college. But then I also decided, oh my gosh, I think I know exactly what I need to do. I need to become a nurse. I've been living in a hospital for so long. Am I a nurse? Oh,
right.
No. You introduced me to LMFT. So these are the things.
That's
I'm like,
right.
Oh, let me do this. Let me do this. Let me keep so busy and figure out what can I do. I want to be in a hospital helping other families with, you know, sick children. And so I started nursing school. We're living in New Orleans, which we decided to stay in New Orleans. Remember, it's a few hours from our family. We decided to stay in New Orleans because we had literally just moved right before both girls died. So we said, okay, for whatever reason, we're here. We have a lease, you know, we'll just stay here. We'll have time, the two of us, to figure what we're going to do next. And then Katrina happened.
No way. You added that part in.
2005, it was Katrina.
Like,
so we're in New Orleans.
I guess the dates work out.
We're in New Orleans and we had to evacuate. So, but this is what I love about, I feel like God's sense of humor. He knows sometimes when he's trying to guide you down a certain road and you're just like, no, I'm going to do what I want. He will put you there.
Yeah.
So he's like, okay, you know, I think maybe I should go home. We're like, no, we'll hang around New Orleans. Okay, well, here's Katrina. And there was nursing school. I had just started nursing school in New Orleans too. So we moved, we come back to Lafayette. So, you know, Lafayette was spared from the storm. I was diving into nursing school. And I find out I'm pregnant for baby number three. And once again, this the immediate reaction was like, I do not want anyone to know this. What is everyone going to think? What if something's wrong? How irresponsible we look as a couple. And as luck would have it, baby number three also had the syndrome. At this point, once again, it was almost like our each child, things were more severe health-wise. And so for our third baby, which we know was a girl, we named her Hannah. I actually miscarried at 19 weeks because she was so, there were so many issues with her. Yeah. We really thought, okay, well, God's trying to tell us that we're not meant to have children. And those were also things that were being said to us from loving family members,
and,
even.
And sorry, Adrienne, I didn't mean to cut you off there. I just want to stay on that loss for a second, because before I got married and before we started having children, I was not aware of how many women have miscarriages, right? And through maturing and becoming an adult and hearing from Ashley and her consoling friends, right? I really saw in my kind of late 20s, 30s, wow, like a lot of women lose babies to miscarriage. And so I just want to say again to women who are out there in the audience, I know just because I've watched it, so many women miscarry and they don't do any work, emotional work around that. I just wish, I hope, right, that we can make such an impact in this world that women understand that there is work available to them to grieve and to heal these miscarriages, because these are devastating losses for these women. You know, I've seen it. And the good news is for me, we do have friends that have gone through this process, this method of grief recovery work around that loss. And then I know a lot of women who don't, and they kind of move forward, and them and their partner, you know, continue to work on the pregnancy. But there are so many of us that have lost a child, you know, in the womb, and it is absolutely work that affects us negatively, emotionally, and work that we can do. So I just wanted to stop there for a moment and not pass that. And again, I'm not saying you did this, but it's like, I think in society, we would minimize that loss versus Anna and Emma, right? And it's like, no, you named her. That was Hannah, right? And it's like, these are heartbreaks in our life, in our world, right? And there's work we can do so we don't just haul that hurt around for us for the rest of our lives, right? So anyway, please continue. I just wanted to point that out.
You make such a great point. And I've helped women who have miscarried. And some of what I hear them say immediately is, well, but I didn't go through what you went through. Well, but my child,
right?
I was only so many weeks pregnant. It's dismissing their own grief and losses. I mean, for a while I struggled with telling anyone what I went through, because I don't ever want someone to feel as though, you know, what we went through in the hospital, it's different. It's nothing more than different. It is different.
Right.
And just like my husband and I, we are so incredibly happy that we have two healthy children. I have a 14-year-old son and an 11-year-old daughter. So numbers 4 and 5 were healthy. And even the losses that we experienced with Emma, with Anna, and with Hannah, we can't wrap our minds around what it would be like if one of our healthy children, if something happened to them now. No, so it's such a dangerous thing, but to compare, well, my grief versus your grief, and I always tell people, like, don't get fixated on what I've gone through. And it is hard to share my story with my clients, because it is, like I said, kind of this movie, like, oh my gosh, you really went through all of that. And when my clients I don't want it to be about me or what I've gone right. through. Because then I notice they yep. immediately try to like, oh gosh, well, what I want, that's nothing compared to, I don't want you to do that, because your losses right. are 100% felt and experienced by you the same way as mine were.
I just want to say that, and I may get in trouble for saying this, but.
Ooh, by who? Who would you get in trouble with?
You'll see in a second. Okay. I have found that in terms of the hierarchy of losses that society places, right, is they, you know, society is going to say that the worst loss you could ever have is lose the loss of a child, right?
Right.
And then, unfortunately, right, Adrienne, you have the trump card of that, and you say, well, I've lost three mm-hmm. children, right? And then Adrienne only gets to feel sad for a second, but you know what we're going to do, Adrienne? We're going to go find you someone who's lost five children, right? And then after that, we can't even have that person grieve and hurt, because we're going to find someone that lost seven children plus a limb plus their wife.
Right.
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 And when we have to get away from this thinking, right, is we have to get away from this pecking order of grief. There's no ranking system. There's no NFL draft for how many losses you've had, and therefore other people can't play in the game. The fact of the matter is, based on our life experience, right, we all have hearts that are smashed into 1,000 pieces over the losses we've endured, right? And the reason I know that Adrienne has done her work to heal her heart. Now, again, I'm not saying that she doesn't have sad days or, you know, again, Adrienne can tell us about the reality of what it's like to have had these losses from her past. But even that you're proposing that you don't want other people minimizing, you don't want people, you know, saying, I can't do any work because your loss is so great. That's how I know you've done the work. In the comments of this podcast, when I put it on YouTube, there are going to be people who haven't found the work that has helped them, that maybe have lost a child, and me even proposing that other people can do work around other grief, they will in the comments say, how dare you propose that other people can do grief work? This is the worst loss ever. And really, nothing else really matters, right? No other work matters because of this loss. And that breaks my heart, okay? I don't want that for people, but I also can't keep quiet about these things because I've been doing this now across the world for 12 years. And so I want to challenge people that have lost a child to look into this work, because I have found that there's kind of two camps here when it comes to the loss of a child. You have a camp where that loss and that grief turns into that person or that couple's identity. And they're going to year after year tell the story, and that is going to be their new identity in their life, is my name is so-and-so, and I'm the person that lost this child 2 years ago or 17 years ago or 23 years ago. Okay. And I don't want that for people. I've also worked with adult children who want to come and grieve and complete their relationship with a living parent who, after the loss of their sibling, was never there for as a parent for them for the rest of their lives. Right. So these are the things that are at stake if we don't openly talk about different options that people with the loss of a child in this case have, other options that they have, other tools that they can apply to heal from these unimaginable things, okay? In no way am I trying to minimize that loss, but again, the idea that we have to have a ranking system and loss right. really does, like you said, if there's 12 people in a room, there's only one person that gets to actually do any work, because the other 11 of us have to minimize our losses,
right?
Okay? We can't even look at them because this person is the worst, don't you know, right? It's like the first time I went to this grief recovery, the training you did in 2019, right? The first time I did it, I was 18 years old in Florida. And I remember my dad just saying, Cole, I got you a plane ticket and you're going to get certified in the grief recovery method, you know? And by the way, I'm not the most mature 18-year-old, I can promise you this, you know, but my dad loved me and he just wanted me to have this experience. So I get there. And I'm with like 12 people, and they're all adults, and they all have what I perceive to be big losses, real losses. I'm 18. What do I know? Right. And thank God that this method is so gentle and so loving and so welcoming that all the, you know what all those adults did? They put their arm around me and they honored my heartbreak. And we got into the work, and guess what? I had plenty of heartbreak at 18. Maybe it wasn't the same as their heartbreak, but no one wanted to say, oh, you know what? Come back, kid, when you have some real grief, right? I found some stuff I needed to heal from, and I'm glad I did, right? I've used those tools for a lot of my life. So anyway, I just want to, again, say thank you for being aware that when you talk about your losses that are very significant losses, no one would deny that. That we're not wanting that to be, okay, now you guys just minimize your own thing, right? You're honoring, hey, no, your heart was broken into 1,000 pieces just like mine was.
Absolutely.
Right? And there's enough room in this world for us to both do work and to support each other, right? And a lot of the time people don't get that when we say, well, do you group people by loss? Do you all have to have the same loss to be in the same group? How could you have a widow next to a divorcee? And we just say, just show up and we'll kind of show you how that all goes, right? And you know, by week two or three, they're crying together. They're hugging each other. We've all identified all of our hearts are in 1,000 pieces, and there's enough room for us all to do the work, sit next to each other.
Absolutely. Right.
And, you know, and I wanted to have you on because I find that the people that have the hardest time believing what I'm saying right now are people who have lost a child, mm-hmm. Okay? But I'll tell you that in one out of every three groups I have, there's 12, 15 people in a room, and there's a couple of people that lost a child, and there's a couple of people that had a divorce, and there's a couple of people that lost a spouse to death, and there's one person that's working on the loss of a pet, and there's a person that's working on a bankruptcy, and then there's another person over here that's working on the loss of health, or their spouse has Alzheimer's. There's another person over here working on a living dad that never showed up to them like a dad should have. And they've been heartbroken their whole life and grieving that relationship their whole life. Okay. And until they found our stuff, they didn't even look at that as grief, and no one else would help them get there. Okay. And all 12 or 15 of those people can do powerful work, and all 12 and 15 of those people can support each other once we get past the nonsense that's put out there in society, which is, my case is different. You can't recover from my case. Oh, I just found someone with what looks like a worse case than me. Now I got to really not even work on my case, right? And that stuff has to go, right? And I'll go to my grave saying these kind of things, and I'm fine taking some heat over it because, you know, sometimes these opinions aren't popular, but I know them to be true. So I got to say it. And this is probably at this point the caffeine talking. So let me turn it back over to you, Adrienne.
No, I want to hear from you. It is 100% correct. And I'm thinking too, I see a lot of children too. And in fact, I was our priest would do, like, he would have talks for parents to attend if their children were in, you know, in the religious formation classes. And he wanted a therapist to address any topics that we thought parents might need to know or, you know, or address with them for these little meetings. And one of the therapists got sick right before, and he was like, hey, Adrienne, would you like to talk to all of these parents? And I was like, oh, my God.
Wow.
It was like a few days before. Yeah. And so I said, yeah, sure. And I said, well, what do you want me to talk about? And he's like, whatever you think, parents, you know, whatever would be important. And I immediately knew that I wanted to talk to all of the parents about grief in their children. And the first question I asked, and it was a church full of parents because they had to be there, you know, but I asked them,
yep,
you know, raise your hand if you believe your children have grieved any losses. And there were, I could maybe three or four hands came up. And when asked, you know, okay, what did your child go through? It was like, well, you know, grandparent died. There, I don't even think any of them identified a pet loss as loss for a child. And so, but it was like grandparents. And then there were a few parents who were divorced. So I went into all of the ways that kids grieve. And you could see the look on all of these parents' faces. These are not things that they would have known. They were so incredibly thankful and grateful that I brought this information to them. But they truly did not recognize all of the changes that children go through, little things that they might think are so insignificant. Today, your friend didn't want to talk to you at school, or, you know, bullied, all the ways, especially with social media now and all the things that kids have to face. So it's incredible just how unaware our world is when it comes to what grief is.
Amen. Yeah. You're speaking to the choir here. And it is, it's one of those things where it's like you said, and I think we should real quick just list out a couple of other options so people understand. Like, I say this in my trainings quite a bit. Again, grief is about the conflicting feelings caused by the change in or end of a familiar pattern of behavior. So let's say that I'm a high school kid and I went to school with all of these kids for my whole life, kindergarten, and now we graduate 12th grade, right? And don't you know, I got the partial college scholarship for baseball, and everyone, my peer group, parents, and my friends, they all want to say, we're so proud of you. We're so excited for you. You know, you're getting started. You got your whole life ahead of you. Well, what am I doing in that instance? I am grieving. I am grieving a tremendous change in what is familiar to me. But how confusing is it for that 17-year-old kid? Because no one's mentioning that at all. All we're doing is mentioning the positive and the excitement for the future. And we're not talking about what I lose by moving to that next step, right? There's a tremendous amount of fear there. So that night, on graduation night, what do I do to cover those feelings that are in me? I drink a little bit more than I usually do at those parties. And then I get in my pickup truck and then I wrap it around a tree. You know, maybe it was me in that car. Maybe it was four of my friends in that car. But when we say that unresolved grief, like, destroys lives, you and I could tell a million stories like that where listeners would never have correlated graduation night for high school kids to a major grieving experience where they have to go and numb that pain in a way that normally they wouldn't have to at that level. And that causes accidents, right? This happens with domestic violence. This happens with suicide. This happens with, you know, the list goes on what grief does to us as a society on a daily basis at any age level. Yet it is never given credit for what it does. And that's why we, you and me, and all the people that do this work, that's why we're passionate about getting the word out there, because we're trying to scream from the rooftops, from the mountains, that, like, guys, we can call it trauma this decade, and we can call it anxiety and stress the last decade, and we can call it all of these other things, but for whatever reason, we are terrified to call it grief. And there are mountains of grief in every one of us, and we go to numb that pain, right? And it doesn't have to be that way, right? And that's why we're really doing what we're doing. So anyway, keep going, Adrienne. Please, I love this part of your story. So you're telling this whole room full of parents, hey, here's some other grief events that your kids probably have, where they started with maybe two of them in the room thinking their kids have had grief experiences. And now they're probably all figuring out that every kid they have qualifies.
Right.
Yeah.
And I mean, even after they said, oh my gosh, like, thank you so much, because, you know, we're going to do things different with our kids. We're not going to tell them, like, oh my gosh, don't think about that. You're 13. Who cares about that? Or ignore them. Who are they to you? Or, you know, whatever we tell our kids, and we've all done it, you know, we've all kind of, we want to take their pain away. We don't want them to be sad. So we tell them that they shouldn't. Don't think about that. Yep. That's crazy. That's silly. Don't worry about that. You know, so they, and some of these parents said, oh my gosh, I would pay to hear this kind of talk. This is like a lot of really important information that parents need to know. And I always refer people to, I tell them chapter 3 is one of my favorites in the handbook, because you become so aware of all of the things you learned and were told about how to handle the tough stuff that never works. Never works.
Yep.
And so I even tell parents, if you don't even believe that there's any grief with your children, just read this. You'll start to understand, you know, how we don't even know how to handle our own stuff. How can we teach our children how to handle their stuff?
Yeah. Amen. And, you know, part of the reason that I love that you're an LMFT is that, again, not talking bad about therapists or counselors. I think they're a lot of them are excellent. I do think that there is a hole in their education when it comes to grief, because if you were to, as a parent, if you were to bring your child to see a counselor about dealing with issues, right, there's a strong probability they will not correlate anything that kid's going through with unresolved grief either, right? And that shout out to all of our thousands of counselors and therapists like you that identified, we spent a half a semester in school on this topic, yet a lot of people that I'm seeing have grief and I don't know how to navigate those conversations, right? And they seek out our stuff and come get some education. But, you know, it's the same with the kids, right? This just goes undetected, even with mental health professionals, right? And that's a frustration for me is like, and again, we're going to get a little controversial here, but it's like, what are the two main symptoms of grief, unresolved grief, right? Reduced ability to concentrate and a lack of energy. Well, look, if I really loved grandma or grandpa, or I love that dog that we've had my whole life, or I just love that house and we moved, or I love that town and we moved, or I had a loss of trust in somebody, a babysitter, because they were inappropriate with me, or, you know, or the list goes on. All of those things are losses of trust, they're loss events, they're grief. And all of a sudden I have a reduced ability to concentrate and my grades slip, right? Again, if we misdiagnose what's going on for that children, we have no shot at treating them or giving them any kind of tools that can help. And it's, you know, I don't think it's dramatic to say it's an epidemic that we're not reaching or helping our kids effectively because we're missing a huge piece of the puzzle on what's going on in their hearts and in their tummy. And that's unresolved emotional experiences from their past.
I think I even said this when I was talking with Mike in the video clip where it's, you know, people come into my office and they say, you know, oh, I'm depressed. I have depression. They will diagnose themselves with depression or with anxiety or ADHD. I can't focus. I can't pay attention. I can't. And it's not even much unpacking to find out, like, look at all that you have been going through. Yes, you're sad. I'm not going to use the D word because depression is not something that you just throw around, you know, the diagnosis. So, you know, right. Yes, you're sad. Yes, you're worried. You can't sleep. You're struggling on the day to day, you know, just to accomplish anything. And yep. This is grief. Yep. This is grief. Yeah. And it's not to say that those things don't exist. Yes, there is depression. Yes, there is clinical depression and anxiety, and there is attention deficit hyperactivity. There are those things, but not everything is. I mean, just in my experience, probably 80%, 90% of what I see is not those things.
Yeah, and you know, and I would agree. And I'm coming from the same place. I think those other things do exist.
Absolutely.
Although,
well, you know, there's chemicals in our brain. Would you say?
Yeah. I mean, no, I'm not quite sure about ADHD and stuff like that. But again, we don't need to go through that. Like you said, I think that there is massive misdiagnosis to a large degree on calling it anything but grief, right? And thank you for mentioning the D word, depression. I didn't say that one in my rant, right? Right? Because right now I hear so much about trauma, right? And I'm like, well, what happened? Oh, my mom died, you know? So, oh, I'm sorry. So like, you have some grief? No, I have trauma. Because that's like the cool word on Instagram right now is trauma.
To go
right?
a step further, it's not even just trauma. They will actually say PTSD. Like I've heard people say PTSD. Right. Like, yeah, wow, do you realize all the things that all the boxes that have to be checked off for it to actually be PTSD?
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah. And you know, and I try and tell people, because look, I'm still, I think you were saying earlier, like, your brain formed when you got a little bit older, you know, out of your 20s. I'm still waiting for my brain to fully form. So like, I just want to put that out there. But I just tell people, just in my own simple kind of way, it's like, just know that if you're going to take on these super high level $15 diagnoses, right, and these super complex things and these disorders and these pathologies, just know that that really like complicates your belief system and like your belief that you're going to recover from this stuff. you know, and then you come and meet me, goofy old me, and I'm like, hey, maybe it's just kind of some sadness and some hurt over these hopes, dreams, and expectations, and it didn't happen how we thought it was going to happen, or, you know, we hoped we were going to have this, and that didn't happen, or, God, that must have really broke your heart when you lost that person, right? Maybe, you know, maybe it's grief. Maybe it's a normal and natural kind of sadness, and we don't need this super complex diagnosis. Now, if you truly have some super complex diagnosis, great. Go see Adrienne. Don't see me, right? Because I'm not qualified for any of that. But I'll tell you what, I've had a lot of people that have come to our work and found tremendous results with just pure and simple, the grief recovery method, using simple feelings, words, and simple tools, and kind of moving away from the complexities that our society likes to put on mental health now, which, again, I would argue we don't even do, right? If you want to do mental health, don't see me. I'm not equipped at that. I help with emotional help. Mm-hmm. Our method is really good at emotional help. In fact, I'll try and get you out of your brain as much as I can when you work with me to try and get you down on your heart. Because that's where I see this work really unlocking people from years and years of hurt is emotional work. Anyway, turning it back to you.
I would have spared myself a lot of grief, no pun intended, if I would have known this all those years ago. I mean, the health problems I have from the stress, it's called Barrett's esophagus, which is like pre-cancer in my esophagus. And there's no doubt, just all the worry. I was always physically sick, my stomach, just all these health problems just from all of the stress of, from the grief that I didn't know what to do with. And I did believe that, well, I'm not running away from it. I'm doing this work for the church. Even before we worked with couples of, you know, who lost children, we were helping, we were giving talks to couples who were engaged that were going to be married in the church. And so we would talk with them. And like I said, we were sharing our story, but that's not doing work. That's not action. Sharing a story is sharing a story. Those aren't steps to work through the pain, because we both know, my husband and I both, I mean, we found out through Ed too, that when you really start to get below the surface and it gets to be so painful, that's when you know, I didn't really do any work. Where we were just like deeper thoughts, deeper memories were so incredibly painful to us. But I watched your video with about your feet. And, we built this wall around ourselves to protect us from hurt. But anything that gets in there, and you know, there are cracks, and when it penetrates, there's a lot of stuff that's going to come out when it's been carried for so long.
Yeah, absolutely. You know, and we're just so you know, we're going to do a 2-part series here with Adrienne. I so appreciate this conversation and what you're bringing to this conversation. We're going to kind of stop part one here. Okay. And then we're going to continue. For those of you watching this, I want to say thank you. Adrienne, I want to say thank you, for just again, pouring your heart out there. Because I know it's in, because you want to help people, you know, and I just love that. And that's what I want to do too. So thank you for being
here.
Thank you. And again, I can't wait to offer you a hug in person.
Yes.
And your husband too. I look forward to meeting him too. And you know, I would love to talk to him at some point, but again, thank you. And we will meet again soon.
All right. Thank you.